In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. Brethren, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do. Through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. O God, who on this day, through your only begotten Son, have conquered death and unlocked for us the path to eternity, grant, we pray, that we who keep the solemnity of the Lord's resurrection may, through the renewal brought by your Spirit, rise up in the light of new life through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter proceeded to speak and said, "You know what has happened all over Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John preached, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power. He went about doing good and healing all those oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses of all that he did, both in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. This man God raised on the third day and granted that he be visible, not to all the people, but to us, the witnesses chosen by God in advance, who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commissioned us to preach to the people and testify that he is the one appointed by God as judge of the living and the dead. To him all the prophets bear witness that everyone who believes in him will receive forgiveness of sins through his name, the word of the Lord. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. Let the house of Israel say, his mercy endures forever. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. The right hand of the Lord has struck with power. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. I shall not die, but live and declare the works of the Lord. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. The stone which the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. By the Lord has this been done. It is wonderful in our eyes. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Colossians. Brothers and sisters, if then you were raised with Christ, seek what is above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Think of what is above, not of what is on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, your life, appears, then you too will appear with him in glory. The word of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Christ, our Paschal Lamb, has been sacrificed. Let us then feast with joy in the Lord. Hallelujah. The Lord be with you.
And
a reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John. On the first day of the week, Mary of Magdala came to the tomb early in the morning, while it was still dark, and saw the stone removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved, and told them, "They have taken the Lord from the tomb, and we don't know where they put him." So Peter and the other disciple went out and came to the tomb. They both ran, but the other disciple ran faster than Peter and arrived at the tomb first. He bent down and saw the burial cloths there, but did not go in. When Simon Peter arrived after him, he went into the tomb and saw the burial cloths there, and the cloth that had covered his head, not with the burial cloths, but rolled up in a separate place. Then the other disciple also went in, the one who had arrived at the tomb first, and he saw and believed, for they did not yet understand the scripture that he had to rise from the dead. The Gospel of the Lord. In 1300 Florence, Italy, the poet Dante recounts a beautiful Easter tradition that they had. Now, just to set the stage, if you've been to Florence, it's a rather large city. Back then, it was behind the old medieval walls. The cathedral was still under construction, but the baptistry, this octagonal building, was already there for 200 years prior. Actually, it was built on the foundations of a baptistry that went back to the earliest Christian times. It was octagonal because it represented the new creation, that the first creation was 7 days, but Easter brought about a new creation, so 8 days. The beautiful mosaics were already in place, which inspired Dante to write his Divine Comedy. Also, later on, we know Ghiberti would put on the bronze doors. But back to the importance of all of this. On Good Friday, in Florence, all the lights went out. All the flames were extinguished. So no candles, no fires and stoves or fireplaces. Homes became cold as a tomb. Darkness surrounded the city. People fasted. But then, at the first Mass of Easter, when it was still dark, the priests would build this big bonfire in the baptistry. The smoke went through the oculus in the ceiling. With that, the bishop would light the paschal candle. He'd come out of the baptistry. A lot of the townspeople were there, outside waiting, and he would proclaim, "Christ our light." From that, they would light their torches or candles. They would go into the baptistry with buckets, get some of the embers, and then go home. On the way, they would greet each other, "Christ is risen, alleluia. Truly, he is risen, alleluia." Then their homes would be lit up, and the stove started for the cooking of food, the fireplaces lit to warm the homes. The importance was, though, they were bringing the light of Easter, the light of the risen Lord, to their homes and their families. They were filling their homes with the warmth of the love of the risen Lord. This story helps us appreciate what is happening in our gospel passage today. Go back to Good Friday. Darkness covered the world. At 3 p.m., Jesus, our Savior, had been crucified on that cross. He is dead. They take him down, cover him with a linen shroud, bury him in a tomb that had never been used before, and then roll the rock at the entrance of the tomb, about a 2,000-pound stone. At the behest of the Jewish leaders and elders, Pontius Pilate orders the Rome sealed, meaning Roman soldiers went, they drove in six pikes, they put ropes crisscrossing, and in the middle at the crossing, a wax seal with the imperial signia. If anyone broke the seal without permission, that person was crucified. At least two Roman soldiers were positioned there, and if a Roman soldier left his post, or if he fell asleep, he was crucified. The point is, no one was getting into that tomb, and no one was coming out of that tomb. Nevertheless, that Easter Sunday morning, when it was still dark, as we heard in the gospel, Mary Magdalene goes to the tomb. The rock's been rolled back. The tomb is empty. The guards are gone. She doesn't know exactly what has happened. She goes and tells Peter and John. They go to the tomb. They see that there are the burial cloths. Now pause. If by chance, which isn't going to happen, some thief went in, passed the Roman guards, broke the seal, went into the tomb, is he going to unwrap a crucified body and leave the burial cloths? Oh, please. And then is he going to fold one up nicely? Oh, please. It didn't happen. So what did happen? Good question. Peter and John, though, would have remembered that three times during his public ministry, our dear Lord predicted, or I should say foretold, that he would have to go to Jerusalem, that he would be handed over to the chief priests and the elders, he'd be crucified, buried, but he would rise again. Still, as our gospel ends, they did not yet understand the scripture that he had to rise from the dead. Just as an aside, if we look at the Shroud of Turin, which I truly believe is the burial cloth of Christ, that scientists will say that that image is really miraculous. It's not painted, it's not done with pigments, it is not something that's burned or scorched, but rather they liken it that some thermonuclear reaction took place, like an atomic bomb went off, and there was this mass release of energy and light by which, they say, our Lord rose through that cloth, leaving this imprint. Also, they found that while it's a two-dimensional image, it's encoded with three-dimensional information, meaning you could produce a three-dimensional image from it. Miraculous. Can't explain it. But when we think about that, something miraculous truly happened. Christ had risen. We know from the Gospels that he does appear later, not as a resuscitated corpse, but as a glorified, risen Christ. Two, the Peter and the apostles, Mary Magdalene and other holy women, to the two disciples on the road to Emmaus, to 500. I have to believe, and Pope St. John Paul II agrees with me, that he must have appeared to his Blessed Mother. Christ had risen, and he then will appear to the apostles on that Easter Sunday evening. He's able to appear, disappear. He's able to eat a meal, be touched. He has his wound marks to show that he died for our sins because our sins had crucified him. Nevertheless, a miracle had changed our Lord, that the divine power of the Holy Trinity raised him up, and he now was glorified, totally changed, body and soul, no longer limited to this time and space. He could be everywhere. He could be anywhere he wanted in an instant. Christ had truly risen. But here then, we also then find the meaning of he had to rise from the dead. Through the resurrection, through the passion, death, and resurrection of our Lord, and we could even go back further through the incarnation, the very mystery that Jesus, true God, became true man, the original sin of Adam and Eve had finally been conquered. All the future sin, the suffering, the death, conquered. All the falsehoods, the lies of Satan, the false promises, the notion of a kingdom of this world, crushed, as was the head of the serpent, Satan himself. What had given way then was a whole new creation. The eighth day, the new Easter creation had taken place. Christ had elevated our human nature to something even better than Adam and Eve had. So when the apostles see this, and then after Pentecost, filled with the gifts of the Holy Spirit, they go out and they proclaim the basic, simple message that brings us here today, that Jesus Christ, true God, entered this world becoming also true man. Jesus perfectly revealed the truth and love of God, God's truth, only one truth, God's truth to us. Jesus suffered for our sins. Only he could take that burden on. Jesus rose from the dead, giving us the hope of everlasting life. Jesus poured forth the Holy Spirit and founded his church. Simple Easter faith. This is what we believe. Because of what happened at Easter, the risen Lord, we're here. Jesus is with his church. Jesus empowers his church. Our Catholic Church goes back to the apostles. They went out, they preached, and we're here, beginning with our own baptism. Through baptism, we share in this whole Easter mystery. We have been recreated as a child of God, made a member of the church, and now the whole saving mystery of our Lord's passion, death, and resurrection have been opened to us. Therefore, on this Easter Sunday, we do renew our baptismal promises. We do reject Satan, his false promises, his lies, his promise of a worldly kingdom, and we profess our faith. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, we profess our faith. We also then can go forth from here, not to go into a tomb. No longer do we fear the tomb. No longer should we ever think we'll be confined to this tomb of darkness because of some sin, some failure, some regret. In a society that likes to be so unforgiving, even canceling, even demonizing, Jesus forgives us. On that night of Easter, the risen Lord appeared to his apostles, and he empowered them as his priests to forgive. He would forgive through them in the sacrament of penance. He said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. What sins you forgive, they are forgiven." And so, my brothers and sisters, how beautiful it was this past Lent to have so many people go to confession. And some of them, it had been a long time. Some had some really heavy burdens of sin, but they came out of that tomb to start a new life. With the risen Lord, we don't have to fear about living in a tomb wrapped in a shroud and face all the sufferings and disappointments of life. They come. But we should know we can leave and know that Jesus is with us, the risen Lord. We have our Lord in the Holy Eucharist. We receive his glorified body, blood, soul, and divinity. How blessed we are. Jesus said, "I am the bread of life come down from heaven. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood will have everlasting life, and I'll raise him up on the last day." So no matter whether we're going through good times or the worst times, Christ is with us in a very special way through the Holy Eucharist. The risen Lord is with us. I think of this lady I knew years ago. Her name was Dorothy, called her Dot, and Dot had suffered from cancer. Basically, her whole lower face was gone. She couldn't talk, she couldn't eat, she had a feeding tube, she could only write on a little chalkboard. We'd bring her Holy Communion in the sense of a vial of consecrated precious blood, which we would pour down that feeding tube. And I would always say to her, "Dot, remember, Jesus loves you." And she'd write on her little board, "I love Jesus." That's a risen faith. She's not confined to a tomb. Yes, she passed. But the goodness is, her example converted many of her family. And then, too, do we worry about death? We shouldn't, because Christ has conquered death. We don't live our life looking at a tomb. And when we do pass, or someone we love passes, we don't look at a tomb. We pray, and we have hope. Jesus said, "I'm the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he should die, will have everlasting life." This is our hope. And then, too, we aren't stuck in a tomb of darkness where some dictator of ideology stands at the entrance and says, "There's no truth, but I'll tell you what you have to believe. Jesus is the truth. The risen Lord is the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus said, the truth will set you free." So we aren't going to live by some ideology or fear. We live for Christ. Just think, what a tragedy it is that this day there are political powers that call this Transgender Visibility Day. What an affront. This is Christ Visibility Day. This is Easter. And that's what we proclaim. The risen Lord is the way, the truth, and the life. So my brothers and sisters, we celebrate this Easter. The key, though, is what happens when you leave here. Like the people of Florence leave bearing the light, we might not have a physical flame from this Paschal candle, but surely we can bring the light of Christ to our homes by our words, our deeds, our actions. We can fill our homes with the warmth of God's love. For Christ has conquered. Christ is risen. Amen. Alleluia. Let us stand now as we renew our baptismal promises. Dear brethren, through the Paschal mystery, we have been buried with Christ in baptism, so that we may walk with him in newness of life. And so now that our Lenten observance is concluded, let us renew the promises of holy baptism, by which we once renounced Satan and his works, and promised to serve God in the Holy Catholic Church. And so I ask you, do you renounce Satan?
I do.
And all his works?
I do.
And all his empty promises?
I do.
Do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth?
I
do. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was born of the Virgin Mary, suffered death and was buried, rose again from the dead, and is seated at the right hand of the Father?
I
do. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting? And so, may Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us new birth by water and the Holy Spirit, and bestowed on us forgiveness of our sins in Christ, keep us by his grace in Christ Jesus our Lord for eternal life. Amen. Let us offer our petitions. Our dear Lord Jesus Christ said that where two or more are gathered in his name, that he would be in their midst and hear their prayers. With this confidence, we offer these petitions.
For all of our church leaders, especially Pope Francis, Bishop Burbidge, and our parish priests, that they will preach the gospel with courage and conviction, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our nation, that together we will promote the common good of all, safeguard the sanctity of marriage and the family, and defend the rights to life and to religious freedom, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For justice and peace among nations, especially Ukraine and the Middle East, and for those who serve in our law enforcement, military, diplomatic, and intelligence services to make peace, we pray to the Lord. For Christians who face persecution and genocide, especially in communist and Islamic countries, that the Holy Spirit will keep them strong in the faith, and for all non-believers, that the Holy Spirit will move them to faith in our risen Savior, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the Israeli hostages held by Hamas and all the innocent victims of war, terrorism, and violence, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For each of us, that this Easter we will be renewed in faith and fully committed to our Catholic Church, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have received the sacraments of initiation and entered into full communion with the Church this Easter, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the acceptance of vocations to the priesthood and religious life, that young men and women from our own families will heed Christ's call and offer their lives to Him who gave His life for us, and for our parish seminarians, Deacon James Joseph, Gabriel Godet, Michael Gibbons, and John Anthony Buono, and for Sister Monica Baptiste Whalen and Sister Abigail Therese Jones, novices for the Dominican Sisters in Nashville, and for Joanna Shaw, postulant for the Carmelites in Port Tobacco, Maryland, we pray to the Lord. For the sick and homebound, especially Father Penizzato, and for our deceased, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Paul and Claire Dugan, for whom this Mass is offered, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for our own personal intentions, which we offer in the quiet of our hearts, we pray to the Lord.
Heavenly Father, we ask you to hear all our prayers, even those prayers held within our hearts, to grant them in accord with thy divine word, through Christ our Lord. Amen. In calling upon the prayers of our Blessed Mother, we pray. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Our second collection is for our parish construction debt.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed be God forever. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become our spiritual drink. Blessed be God forever. Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good, good of all his holy church. Exultant with paschal gladness, O Lord, we offer the sacrifice by which your church is wondrously reborn and nourished. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but on this day, above all, to laud you yet more gloriously when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For he is the true Lamb who has taken away the sins of the world. By dying, he has destroyed our death, and by rising, restored our life. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exalts in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread. And giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with St. Agnes and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope and Michael our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Lamb of God, behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, my soul shall be healed. So as the second collection's being taken up for our construction debt reduction, just to a couple of announcements. The first is simply that our poor box collection today is for the Little Sisters of the Poor in Washington. And then also just to offer a word of thanks for all those who helped make our Easter celebration possible, really all during our Holy Week. So we could think in our own hearts about our altar society, our sacristans, the ushers, lectors. Also, even though this is the quiet mass, we have a beautiful choir. So many people that we can thank for their good service so that we do have the parish that we do. But also with how wonderful it is that we have our four seminarians from the parish with us for Holy Week, such a wonderful help. So please keep them particularly in your prayers so that they may persevere as their journey to priesthood, and especially for our deacon, James Joseph, who will be ordained this June. Let us pray. Look upon your church, O Lord, with unfailing love and favor, so that renewed by the paschal mysteries, she may come to the glory of the resurrection through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go forth, the Mass is ended. Alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.